26 years ago, unknown to us, my husband Anand and I started on the most exciting journey of our life, the journey of autism. We had just become parents to a cherubic little boy with a beautiful smile, a lovely disposition, a fierce streak of independence, and one who thrived on music. The journey of autism has been like no other. It has brought us many, many insights into the world of autism for sure, but also into our world, which until autism decided to hold us by the hand, we were blissfully unaware of. And it threw up a lot of questions. Questions about our perceptions, our presumptions, which in turn led to other questions. What, when, where, how? And most importantly, why? So how many people here know a person with autism? Well, it may come as a surprise to many that the incidence of autism world over is 1 in 60, which means that in India, the number of people with autism is equivalent to the population of Mumbai. There are doctors, engineers, chartered accountants, architects, copywriters, media people, cooks, job workers, homemakers, singers, dancers, poets. In fact, every 60th person in the world has autism. Perhaps the one sitting next to you. There are lots of myths surrounding autism. The most common being that autistic people have limited speech and communication and lower intelligence. While this is true for many, most people with autism are just like you and me. Their abilities match with ours, and some even belong to the Mensa Club, with IQs as high as Einstein's. What sets them apart is their different way of perceiving the world. They think, sense, and feel differently. And because of that, they express themselves differently. And very often, we don't get them and tend to believe that they have a socio-communicative issue. Why won't you help me? Today was a big day at art class. We learned a new skill, to paint bamboo stalks with a crow quill. You said that I would love it, and you were eager to see me paint my masterpieces. My mama says that I have art in my DNA, right there with my autism, jostling shoulders to each be in the limelight. My aunt is an artist. The autism is all mine. It felt different, this crow quill, from a pen or a paintbrush. All of us struggled. We love art class in my special school. I am the star. When I talk about my art, everyone sits up and listens. As soon as we began, Meena started crying in frustration, and you went up to her and calmed her down, told her that she could take your help. You held her hand and guided her in a warm, hushed voice. Just then, Ajay cried out, "Teacher, the ink is dripping," and you ran to his side. You showed him how to shake off excess ink from the nib and draw in light strokes. My work was coming through beautifully. But how do I draw the curved line with my crow quill? I looked to you for help, but you had your back to me helping the new girl. I started mumbling, but you didn't look. I made some guttural sounds to call your attention. You glared at me. I clapped for you, but you ignored me. So I pulled your arm. "Help," I said silently. You did turn to give me your full attention. "Stop it at once, it's bad behavior," you said. Meena and Ajay and all the others stared. And you said to them, "When will she learn? That is what I'm doing. Look, look. I took my art from the easel for you to see." "No, no, no, put it down," you said. So I did, on the floor, and you screamed, "Pick it up immediately." I ran out confused. away from your voice, the stairs. And you came after me and pulled me back to class, looked at me with wide angry eyes and said, "What is it? Why do you fly into these rages? What gets into you? What do you want me to do?" What gets into you? Why do you fly into these rages? What do you want me to do? Why is it bad behavior for me to ask for help? Why won't you help me? It is not that autistic people don't reach out. It is often that we ignore their outstretched hand. Who hasn't felt the intense pain of social rejection at some point or the other in their lives? For being women in a male-dominated world, or being non-heterosexual in a homophobic world, or belonging to a lower caste in an upper caste society, or to a minority religion. Rejected for behaving, dressing, eating, celebrating differently? Could it be the same basis that sets the neurotypical us in a different category from the autistic them, relegating them at best to the fringes of society and at worst to being social outcasts simply because they don't fit into the dominant discourse of society as we know it? 2 decades ago, a few of us came together and set up a support group called Forum for Autism, essentially a network to help autistic persons and their families negotiate typical society. We moved from an era where special schools had no idea how to address the needs of our children to achieving access into regular schools and colleges, even securing concessions for them for their board exams, and very recently creating inroads into open employment. Many families joined us in this journey and have benefited from these inroads and widened them. Our children moved from being toddlers to teenagers and now adults. But the shattering reality faced by most families with adults is an inability to live with them and address their needs anymore. Essentially, brought on by years of forceful and disrespectful instruction based on a rigid need for compliance, even sometimes at the cost of emotional and physical well-being, and holding an unrealistic expectation of needing them to fit into our world while making very little attempts to trying and understanding theirs. Why you can't win with me? I remember the day I walked into your center with Mama, so well lit and cool and brightly colored, and you said to me, "Climb the ladder." I was delighted. It was years since I had climbed any ladder, years since I used play equipment in parks. You see, I'm almost an adult now and 6 feet tall. I approached the freestanding ladder with excitement. One rung, two rungs, three rungs. I have grown since I last did this. There I was, strung out on the third rung, hanging half over the top, my center of gravity wobbling precariously outside my body, marveling at the intervening years that had made this most favorite of my activities challenging to me today. And then you came to me and said, "Come on, go on, right to the top, do it." I looked down at you with a half smile that I hope said, "Surely you're joking. I can't continue, I will fall." But your look was unrelenting. And once more you said, "Do it. A big boy like you can." I looked at you once again, hoping my look spoke my thoughts. "Oh, but that is the problem, you see. I'm a big boy now, and it appears that I can't climb to the top anymore. It breaks my heart too." Always on cue, my mama, the eternal negotiator, stepped in with attempts to get me to try to do your bidding. And you said to my mama, There is no point explaining these things to these children. Are you going to keep explaining everything to him all your life? And then you put your hand on my bottom and pushed me up the ladder, leaving me with just two choices, to fall or to jump off. My mama always says that I have good survival instincts. I jumped. And you ran at me, thrust me back onto the ladder with a "do it now." I panicked and pulled back. You yanked at my arm. We struggled, we grappled, a searing pain tore through my shoulder, and before I knew what was happening, you had thrown me down and I was pinned, my face pressed into the floor mat, my hand twisted behind me and your knee in my back, gasping, not knowing why. My mama said I was held down like a criminal. I felt more like the deer on Nat Geo, breathing his last as the leopard's jaws closed on his jugular. We left soon after, Mama and I, both in a daze. She never took me back. But I learned my lesson from you that day. Nobody can force me to do anything I don't want to anymore. My strength is feared wherever I go. I can always get my way. You can't win with me now. You can't make me do your bidding anymore. Do you know why? My dear, you may be big and you may be strong, but I'm bigger and stronger, and I have age on my side. Every single day, 1 in 60 people the world over ignore their natural way of being, ignore their amazing way of perceiving the world, of thinking, feeling, sensing it differently, of expressing themselves differently. Every single day, as they strive to fit into a boring, non-autistic world. So many of our children, beautiful, broken souls. You see this happening all around you, don't you? Even if you don't know a person with autism. In fact, aren't we sometimes guilty of this ourselves? Of using the privileges that society gives us, privileges of gender, sexuality, caste, religion, to try and force the have-nots to fit into and conform with the dominant discourse of the haves. Of all the insights that autism brings, the most important is that life is all about embracing differences. For this is what autistic people do day in and day out as they try to understand, accept, and assimilate the ways of us neurotypicals. You probably know them as the people who think out of the box, the ones who don't give up easily, the ones who keep trying to understand your point of view while not giving up on trying to get you to understand theirs. We, parents, families, and friends of persons with autism, are privileged to know them. And if you looked around you, you'd be lucky enough to meet them too. In the present day, the world over, but especially so in India, when high walls divide the us from the them, every day narrowing the definition of us, autism is a beacon of hope. It shows us how to keep blurring the boundaries and accepting, understanding, assimilating differences, leading us to a society that sees the beauty of an inclusive and wonderful, diverse world. For what is inclusion, if not a celebration of diversity? Why I reached out to you, why you could help me do it. It was my very first therapy session with you. My teary 3-year-old self curled into a tight ball into the crevices of Mama's lap as though to return to the womb. You had brought a big bag of toys, which you emptied onto the floor near me while I continued to bawl and push into your lap. I wasn't looking, but I was perceiving your every move anxiously. Will she force me to look at her with her bony fingers grasping at my chin? Will she engulf my hand in her pincer grip and force me to touch something gooey like clay? I was prepared to resist. But you just sat there, running your hands through the toys, asking nothing of me while I cried. I reached for a yellow Lego piece, so you played with some yellow ones. And when I reached for red, you played with red ones. And blue, you took blue. I saw the pattern. I reached for two blocks, one red and one blue. And you took two of the same colors as mine. Tup, 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 you said, and slapped your blocks together. I threw mine away at once, suddenly afraid of what you wanted me to do. You let me be. Let me cry. Let me try and return to the womb. You continued to run your hands through the toys, and when I next reached for a block, your hand magically appeared under my reaching one. I took one. Surprised at my own audacity, I slid off Mama's lap onto the floor next to you, reaching out for more. And you sang my favorite song, my Mama's lullaby, in your sweet, kind, melodious voice. My eyes jumped to your shining ones. How did you know my song? That is when you smiled your warm smile at me and said, "Hi." I jumped back into the crevices of my Mama's lap, my 3-year-old self curled into a tight ball as though to return to the womb and resumed my throaty crying. You let me be. The session ended. I couldn't believe it. I had met someone who understood how difficult it was for me to meet new people, try my hand at new things. It made me feel safe. For the first time, I felt secure to explore my world. There were no hidden agendas. Today, I'm a working man and I take the bus to my workplace. As I go about my routine, I often remember that first session. I wonder how things would have unfolded if I had not felt secure in the knowledge that you would let me bloom at my chosen pace.